Good morning to you all. Today we'll learn about application of Gauss law to calculate electric field due to continuous uniform distribution of charge. Okay, first let us see how to find the electric field due to uniformly charged infinite wire, an infinitely long wire which is uniformly charged. How to find the electric field due to an infinitely long uniformly charged wire? Right? Look at this. This is an infinitely long, I have taken part of it, infinitely long uniformly charged wire whose charge density is lambda. Charge density, as I have told you earlier, is the charge per unit length. Let the charge per unit length of this infinitely long wire be lambda. It is called linear charge density. I want to find out the electric field due to this. Then, by usual method, we need to consider the elementary portions of the charged wire. Let us say I want to find electric field at point P. If I want to find electric field at point P, then the charges which are there here can be considered as point charges. So if you consider point charge, the electric field at this point due to this particular point charge at perpendicular distance r from here will be radially outwards. So we know that a point charge will be always exerting electric field radially outward. To make it more clear, I will draw separately one more diagram. Now I am drawing an infinitely long charge wire. Consider this is an infinitely long charge wire, right, which is having a uniform charge density lambda. Charge density is not taken as charge per unit length. Suppose if I want to find out electric field at this point P, then we assume that there is a point charge here. The electric field due to this point charge at this distance, let us say r, will be radially outwards. But you see the charges which are present on the either side, they will also exert radial electric field in this way. So like this, if you go on considering, let us say I am considering two elementary charge particles, two elementary portions, two elements of this wire which are at the same distance from here. The electric field due to this is in this direction, radially outwards, and the electric field due to this will be, yes, it can be drawn like this. Now, the net electric field at this point, if you look at it, it will be acting only along horizontal direction. The vertical components of electric field, if you look at the vertical components of electric field, the vertical components of electric field cancel each other. The electric field, you can see, because the vertical components of electric field are, they are in exact opposite direction. So when they are in exact opposite direction, they cancel each other. Whereas the horizontal component of electric field, they add up to give you finally electric field which is perpendicular to the wire. Similarly, on the other side also, if you draw here, the electric field will be always perpendicular to the wire. At any point, thus we can prove that since it is infinitely long, uniformly charged wire, at any point, if you take, the electric field is always perpendicular to the charged wire. Okay. Now, if we do not apply Gauss law, then we have to consider a small element of this wire and electric field due to this small element of the wire we need to consider. Then we have to integrate the electric field due to all such elements of wire from one end to another end, from zero to infinity. So using that integration method, we'll be able to get the result for electric field. But it takes long time, and the problem is also complicated. So it can be solved very easily by using Gauss law. How is it? Let us see. Now, the same wire I am considering. The same wire. Look at this same wire. I want to find out electric field at this point P. Now, just now we have found out that electric field is always perpendicular to this charged wire at any point. Here also it will be perpendicular. Suppose you want to find out electric field here, here also it is going to be perpendicular, here also it will be perpendicular. Everywhere it is perpendicular to the charged wire. That's how we have found out. Now, it is symmetric. The electric field is quite convenient to understand that it is always perpendicular to the charged wire. Now, how to find out the electric field at any particular point? So, for that, what I consider? The electric field at this distance R we want to find out. So let lambda be the charge per unit length, the charge density, that is charge per unit length. Construct a Gauss law, construct a cylinder. We construct a cylinder of radius R. We construct a cylindrical surface of radius R. The reason is, at every point, you know, the electric field is perpendicular to the uniformly charged wire, and it is away from the uniformly charged wire because we have considered positive charges. Distribution of positive charges. At the other side also it is going to be perpendicular to the charged wire at that particular point. So if we want to find out electric field at a point distance R, let us construct a Gaussian cylinder of radius R. Construct a Gaussian cylinder of radius R so that we can find out electric field at this point P, which is at a distance R. Can be calculated. So that this point P is on the surface of this Gaussian cylinder, and such a surface which is constructed to apply Gauss law is called as Gaussian surface. In here in this case it is Gaussian cylinder. Now we can apply Gauss law, and you see everywhere electric field is constant because it is at a distance R and it is perpendicular to the charged wire. Now, with this symmetry, we can apply Gauss law by constructing a cylinder. Now, applying Gauss law. Total flux linking with this cylindrical surface, the total flux linking with this Gaussian surface must be equal to charge divided by epsilon naught, 1 upon epsilon naught times the charge enclosed, right? Now we need to calculate flux and we need to calculate charge also. So here we are considering only one particular portion of the wire, one particular segment of the wire whose length is L. Let us consider only one segment of the wire that is of length L. And for that length L, we have constructed a cylinder of radius R and of length L. So construct a Gaussian cylinder of radius R so that electric field at this point P can be found out. Not only that, this Gaussian cylinder encloses segment of length L of the wire. So we can write here the cylinder encloses segment, that is portion L of length L, segment of length L of the wire, so that for this segment of length L of the wire, how much is the charge enclosed can be calculated. The cylinder encloses segment of length L of the wire. So for this segment of length L of the wire, what is the charge enclosed? This charge enclosed is Q, that we need to calculate on the right hand side. Left hand side is the calculation of flux. So to calculate the flux, you see there are three types of surfaces, One is the lower circular surface, upper circular surface, and the side cylindrical surface. So we have to apply Gauss law for these three surfaces because the cylinder is enclosed by these three surfaces, right? The cylinder encloses this segment of the wire with these three surfaces, two circular surfaces, top and bottom, and one side cylindrical curved surface. So we need to apply Gauss law, we need to calculate flux for these three surfaces. First, the charge enclosed. Q is equal to the charge enclosed in this length L of the wire. Q is equal to, see, per unit length the charge density is lambda, as we have assumed. Lambda is the charge density per unit length. Therefore, charge enclosed Q is equal to lambda times L. Per length, if it is lambda, therefore for this length of segment of the wire which we have considered, the total charge enclosed is lambda L. Means we have constructed a Gaussian cylinder which can enclose this particular segment of the wire whose length is L, and it has a total charge which is equal to lambda L. So this lambda L can be substituted here in the right hand side. Now let us calculate flux, total flux enclosed. Total flux linking with the Gaussian cylinder. It's equal to flux linking with curved surface area, flux linking with two circular surfaces. So I will write clearly so that there will be no confusion. Flux linking with two circular surfaces. So total flux linking with the entire cylinder can be calculated as flux linking with these two flat circular surfaces, 1 and 2 plus flux linking with the curved surface area, flux linking with the top and bottom flat circular faces plus flux linking with the curved surface area of the cylinder. So like this we can calculate total flux. Now look at this. Consider the upper flat surface. It is a circular surface which encloses this wire of segment of length L, and here the electric field is perpendicular to the wire. As we have come to know, electric field everywhere is perpendicular to the length of the wire. So the electric field is along the surface of the wire, and area vector of this curved surface, I mean area vector of this flat surface is perpendicular to this. So the angle between area vector and electric field is 90 degree. Therefore, flux linking with this circular surface is 0. Similarly, flux linking with the bottom surface, this is also 0. Again, same case, electric field is perpendicular to the length of the wire, and area vector of the area vector of this flat face is perpendicular to electric field. So electric field and area vector are perpendicular to each other. The angle between them is 90 degree. So the flux linking with these bottom and top surfaces is 0. 0 because the angle between area vector and electric field here is 90 degree. So cos 90 is 0. Yes. Plus the flux linking with the curved surface area of the cylinder. You are left with flux linking with the curved surface of the area, which is given by integral of E dot ds. Integral of E dot ds. What does it mean? Consider a small portion of this curved surface area whose area is just ds. If you draw area vector here, area vector ds cap is perpendicular to curved surface. So ds cap and electric field, look at this, they are both in the same direction. So when they are in the same direction, the angle between them becomes 0. So cos 0 becomes 1. So it becomes E ds cos 0. So if you integrate this E dot ds, if you integrate this E dot ds throughout the surface, throughout the side surface, throughout the curved surface, you will get the flux linking with this cylindrical surface. And everywhere, if you see in this side also, if you draw, the area vector and the electric field vector are in the same direction. Area vector is perpendicular to this small elementary area, and electric field is also in the same direction. So E dot ds here becomes again E ds cos 0, that is E ds. Here also it is E ds. So like that, if you go on adding all this E ds, E ds, E ds from one end to another end, you will get the total electric field linking with the curved surface. So that is going to be total flux linking with the curved surface, E dot ds. So next step, it becomes, since everywhere the angle between them E and ds is 0, cos 0 is 1, so it becomes a simple E ds, E ds, integration of ds. Integration of ds is nothing but the total surface area of the cylinder, the total curved surface area, CSA of cylinder, 2 pi r l. So it becomes E into 2 pi r l, E into 2 pi r l, because it is of length l, the cylinder is of length l, and it is of radius r. So the curved surface area of the cylinder is 2 pi r l. So left hand side here you got 2 pi r l, right hand side you got lambda l. Now equating them, 2 pi r, E into 2 pi r l is equal to lambda l, l l cancels. Next we can go for calculating electric field. It becomes simple. Thus we can calculate the flux phi equal to q by epsilon naught. So substitute the value of phi that we have just calculated. It is E into 2 pi r L, total area of the curved surface area of the cylinder, is equal to q lambda L upon epsilon naught. L cancels. When L cancels, you see the equation becomes very simple. Therefore, E is equal to lambda upon 2 pi epsilon naught into r. 2 pi epsilon naught into r. So this implies that electric field is directly proportional to charge density. Electric field is inversely proportional to the distance of the point under consideration where we want to find out the electric field. More the charge density, more is the strength of electric field. That is the meaning of this. E is directly proportional to charge density. More the charge per unit length, more is the strength of electric field. Vice versa. If the charge density is less, less charge per unit length, electric field strength is also less. That's how electric field is directly proportional to lambda. Then electric field is inversely proportional to the distance. This is very important. For a linear charge, this is called linear charge distribution. The electric field is perpendicular to the straight wire. Second thing, electric field is inversely proportional to the distance, not square of the distance. This is to be remembered, very important point. Inversely proportional to distance, not inversely proportional to square of the distance. For point charge, it is inversely proportional to square of the distance. Okay, these are the two points. Then if you want to mention it with vector, see, the vector is acting along the radius vector. It is acting along the perpendicular distance. So I can write it as lambda upon 2 pi epsilon naught r into r cap, where r cap is along the radius, or you can say along the distance. So electric field is perpendicular to the straight charged wire. So these are the points to be remembered. It is perpendicular, it is inversely proportional to the distance, and it is directly proportional to the lambda. Okay, that's how by applying Gauss law, the complex situation of calculating electric field for linear distribution of charge becomes simple. Okay, now let us solve one problem based on this, and in the next video we'll discuss about how to find electric field due to a plane sheet of charge. Look at this problem. This problem is very simple. This is one example. An infinite line charge produces an electric field of 9 into 10 raised to 4 Newton per Coulomb at a distance 2 centimeter. Calculate the charge density. This is an infinite line charge. Let us say it is having a positive charge uniformly distributed throughout it, and let lambda be the charge density. The electric field due to this at distance 2 centimeter is given, 9 into 10 raised to 4 Newton per Coulomb. What is the charge density lambda? That is the question. Distance is 2 centimeter. So we know, just now we have derived, electric field at a distance r is given by E equal to lambda upon 2 pi epsilon naught r. Simple. So we want to calculate lambda. Therefore, lambda is equal to E into 2 pi epsilon naught r. Yes, E into 2 pi epsilon naught r. Now what we will do?
when we get E into 2 pi epsilon naught r, I am multiplying and dividing it by 2, so that I get this 4 pi epsilon naught r by 2. So E into 4 pi epsilon naught r by 2. Why I have taken? Because I know what is the value of 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught. We know 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught is equal to 9 into 10 to the power of 9 Newton meter square coulomb square. Therefore, 4 pi epsilon naught becomes very simple for me. So 4 pi epsilon naught is the reciprocal of this. So 4 pi epsilon naught can be written as 1 by 9 into 10 to the power of 9. Very simple. Instead of substituting 4 into 3.14 into 8.85 into 10 to the power of minus 12 and all, if instead of substituting all those, it is better. We know 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught value. 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught is 9 into 10 to the power of 9. So 4 pi epsilon naught is reciprocal of this. So that's why I am multiplying and dividing it by 2 so that I get 4 pi epsilon naught. So I can write here lambda is equal to E by 2. What is E? 9 into 10 to the power of 4. That is the electric field. 9 into 10 to the power of 4 into 4 pi epsilon naught. 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught is 1 upon 9 into 10 to the power of 9, right? Into r. R is the distance. 2 centimeter. 2 into 10 to the power of minus 2. That is 2 centimeter can be written as 2 into 10 to the power of minus 2. 0.02 meter. Divided by 2. Right? So 9 cancels. 2 cancels. You are left with everything in powers of 10. 10 raised to 4 minus 10 raised to 10 raised to 4 into 10 raised to minus 2 into divided by 10 raised to 9. So that becomes 10 raised to 4 minus 2 minus 9. 10 raised to minus 7. 10 raised to minus 7 coulomb. 10 raised to minus 7 coulomb per meter, because this is charge density, charge per unit length, linear charge density. 10 raised to minus 7 coulomb per meter. So this can be written as 0.1 into 10 raised to minus 6. So the answer becomes 0.1 micro coulomb per meter. Okay, that's how we can solve the problem by using the equation of electric field due to linear charge density for an infinitely long straight uniformly charged wire. We got it as lambda by 2 pi epsilon naught r, where lambda is the charge density. Okay, in the next video we will discuss the same way how to find out electric field due to surface charge density. We consider an infinitely thin large sheet of uniformly charged plane, and we find out electric field by applying Gauss law. So by applying Gauss law, the calculation becomes simple. Okay, that we will see in the next video. Thank you. Have a nice day. Bye.